ladies and gentlemen, a welcome. It's an extraordinary day to be meeting here, given that this time tomorrow we may well be in another war, and the temperature is certainly rising in terms of the language. Apparently last night at the 22 committee meeting, although of course it's meant to be entirely private, David Cameron tells his group, if you vote no, you'll be voting with terrorist sympathisers. The language here, I think, might be a little more temperate, but I'm not quite sure. Here we are, guests of Edelman, who are the biggest PR company in the world. They're in more than 60 cities. And I love the fact that they like intimacy. I feel as if we're actually in Ed Williams' cozy front room for an office Christmas party without the drink. But on the other hand, actually, I'm sure that Ed Williams' front room is bigger than this. So joining us from the comfort of their own homes around the world are many Edelman aficionados, lots of guests, so welcome. And you in the cheap seats in the overspill room, tough luck. We'll be looking for questions from all of you in the real world and also on Periscope later on. But this morning is all about the predictions for next year from our dazzling panel. But if I'd just like to remind you, any of you who were here last year, that the predictions in the survey last year from you lot were so inaccurate that we had a Labour victory and beards were over. So at least for a few of you, I see that's not the case. Anyway, let's introduce our panel. So first of all, Sue Perkins. She is a bon vivre. She's a wit. She's a comedian. She's a writer, broadcaster, and the host of a small-time two-bit baking show. And memorably this year, she revealed that she has been living with a non-cancerous tumour on her pituitary gland for the last 8 years. John Witherow has been a national newspaper editor for 21 years, which begs the question, still no promotion? He's actually the longest-serving British editor after Mr. Dacre, but we'll change that soon, I'm sure. He was first on the Sunday Times and now on the Times, or the Thunderer, as old people call it. He has made a big success of digital, but he himself doesn't read BuzzFeed, not much. However, just to put my oar in for a second, I do think as a completely non-political remark on this, that the Times coverage of Scotland is absolutely incredible. Baroness Tessa Jowell works for the opposition. And I don't really mean Labour, I mean Chime Communications.
just upstairs.
What, in the garret? No. They met during the Olympic Games. They clearly liked the cut of her jib. And she was Minister for the Olympics. I mean, she would like to have been Labour's candidate for the mayoral, but it wasn't to be. And I wonder if she would have changed the result of one of our predictions that we will reveal in a moment. Michael Spencer began dealing in shares when he was a physics undergraduate at university and made £30,000. Probably everybody should be doing that now in England to get over your tuition fee issue. That's chump change for him now, though, because as a CEO of ICAP, he does rather better than that. In 2010, he was named Ernst & Young's World Entrepreneur of the Year. Ed Williams, our host, is a CEO of Edelman UK and Ireland, but everybody in here thinks of him as the really big boss. He loves to run to work, he loves ballet, he's a huge supporter of the ballet, and he loves art. So I'm sure that these guys are going to do a deal, because Michael Spencer is a huge collector of art and he has got a few Lucian Freuds he might want to pass over. So anyway, I'm going to give you what you guys suggested would be the big things for next year before we ask each of our panelists to give 3 minutes on their predictions for 2016. Now, bearing in mind how appalling you all were last year, here we go. You think you have a high level of confidence in the British economy, but you think there'll be much less growth in the European economy. However, 3/4 of you think that we will remain in the EU after a referendum vote. So clearly you'd like to be in there, but you don't care about the economy, it's more about the politics. George Osborne is most likely to be the next Tory leader, but you're split down the middle on whether at the end of 2016, Jeremy Corbyn will be the Labour leader, and that will be a question, of course, for Tessa Jowell. You think that Zach Goldsmith will be the next London mayor. Also a question for Tessa Jowell, had she been the candidate, would you have thought that Zach Goldsmith will be the next London mayor? Most of you think that Hillary Clinton will take the White House. But most fascinating, perhaps, for this audience and for PR is the next cultural phenomenon, being networked but not being connected. So when FaceTime really means FaceTime, you know what that used to be when you actually stand in front of another human being and talk? But let's see if our panel agrees on that. So 3 minutes, and Sue Perkins, first up, 2016.
I don't need 3 minutes. 2016, jetpacks, flying cars, time travel. End of. If you wish me to speak for the full 3 minutes, I can go further and say categorically, 2016 will see the end of salted caramel. I know this from the horses now. It's over. That's not going to happen anymore. We're looking for more woody aromats, bay and rosemary in particular. The Great British prefix will attend to all BBC programming from autumn 2016, leading to the Great British Crime Watch and the Great British Newsnight. There will be a dedicated Michael Portillo channel in which he gets on trains and stays on trains. Mary Berry will be deployed in the Middle East.
Baklava.
Baklava. providing, you know, healing transformation through sponge. And I also, on a more serious note, think it will mean the end of nasty TV. I think we're coming to the end of nasty TV. Shiny floor shows that mock, particularly young people, through the medium of the talent format. I think we're looking at, thankfully, a much more benign, inclusive and open-ended form of Saturday night and Friday night viewing, I hope, anyway. I think, again, on a more serious note, that British television will be put fairly and squarely at the heart of public and political debate next year for two reasons. Firstly, the government is considering the sell-off of Channel 4, which would mean potentially the loss of £200 million in its budget, which will mean the loss of institutions like Jon Snow, Channel 4 News, therefore being probably replaced by emoticons. Middle East, sad face. Local interest stories, smiley face. I also think the other important thing in the delicate ecosystem of British television is the government's continuing interest and hectoring of the BBC, which leads me to my next point. I think 2016 genuinely will see the increase in public demonstrations. The idea that public can and will take control of their own destiny. I think armchair activism, however important through portals such as social media, will fall back a little bit as people take to the streets and realise their voice can and only be heard by standing outside the mother of all parliaments. I think that... Am I out of time?
Well, I think that was a very good stab at 3 minutes. Thank you very much indeed. John Witherow.
Well, the future ain't what it used to be, as Yogi Berra said, or maybe it was Yogi Bear. I mean, the problem is actually, of course, forecasting anything. If I'd been sitting here last year and looked ahead at British politics this year, I would have said there would have been a coalition government. Nick Clegg would have been the decider, whether it was Cameron or Ed Miliband being the PM, that Labour would have done perfectly well in Scotland, and politics would have gone on as much as normal. What happened was a completely unpredictable turmoil. The fact that we still have we have Cameron as an overall prime minister, Miliband's disappeared, Corbyn is the leader of the Labour Party, and the Scots are dominated by the SNP. Completely unpredictable looking ahead. So if we look at next year, the obvious sort of thing is to say that the US election will be between Rubio and Hillary Clinton. I don't think so. I mean, that's too obvious. I think you're going to get Trump v. Clinton, and Trump's going to win. What a terrifying prospect. But that's the sort of thing in this tumultuous world we might expect now. Corbyn, I think, will survive next year, believe it or not, despite all the mayhem that's going on at the moment, because there is no particular alternative that Labour can come up with. The Queen will be 90, and, of course, it's predictable she'll stay on, but I think she'll abdicate and we'll have King Charles. All of these are going to be wrong, by the way, because so don't hold me to them. And ISIS will continue to flourish. It will spread. This bombing won't make any difference. ISIS will now be strong in Libya, strong in Afghanistan. and terror is going to continue for the foreseeable future, which is a rather depressing note to finish on.
Well, I'm sure we can bring some light out of that. Tessa Jowell.
Well, I agree with John that I have a sense of the impossibility of prediction that I can have confidence in, because I thought the outcome of the election would be a coalition, I hoped for a Labour coalition, and I thought that I was going to be the Labour candidate to be Mayor of London, as a number of other people seem to have thought, but neither materialised. I think, however, that there's a period of... we're entering a period of quite radical adjustment. George Osborne, the government, is taking this country to a small state to agree that it's very hard, any of us here, to remember in our lifetimes. And I think that we are seeing, therefore, aided by technology, people resorting more to their own solutions rather than recourse to public services or the traditional agencies. So I think the withdrawal from the traditional expectations of government is something that we will see continuing. And I agree, I think that we will have more demonstrations, but they actually won't change anything. People will feel more activist, but actually nothing will change. And I think that takes me to my second point, which is the future of the Labour Party, which I think is, I agree with John, I think that Jeremy Corbyn will survive for another year because of the new way that the franchise in the Labour Party is now deployed. And I think there will be this growing schism between him, the parliamentary party, and the majority public. And I think that the Labour Party is going through one of its phases, and I've been a Labour Party activist since 1969, so I've been through this before. I've been through going to Labour Party meetings and being spat at and being called Thatcher scum, and you know, the sheer brutal unpleasantness of it. And you know, I would say to our MPs now, you've just got to wise up to this, and you've just got to tough this out, and you've got to build different kinds of alliances and different kinds of coalition. You cannot be bowed by this cyberbullying or by this other, you know, the bullying in meetings. You've just got to toughen up a bit. And then I think the third thing, and we'll come back and perhaps talk about this a bit more, is what is the next disruptive technology that is going to have the impact on our lives that, dare I say, Uber or Airbnb, others that we rely on every day. And I think that the big controversy next year is going to be about the use of drones. You know, Amazon are now trialing. You can watch Jeremy Clarkson promoting Amazon Prime delivery in half an hour using a drone. But also not navigated by him, I don't think. But also the delivery
Thank
of
God
medicines.
For that.
Also the delivery of medicines to remote parts of Africa. Also delivering the internet to remote parts of Africa, but also levels of surveillance that are just quite frankly creepy and unregulated.
Thank you very much indeed. Michael Spencer.
Kirsty, I thought I'd make a few financial predictions. I apparently spent a bit of time working in the financial market, so
here we go.
Keep going.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like some of your people to, you know, have a chance to make a little bit of money out of this show as well. So we've had 8 years of zero interest rates around the world. This is about to change. This month, I expect the US Federal Reserve will make the first move by upwards in rates in the US since 2008. The first move will be a small one. 25 basis points, a quarter of a percent. But this will be the beginning of the change in direction of rates. And during the course of next year, I expect US rates will move from zero today to around 1%. This doesn't sound like a lot, but actually, in the scale of things, it's a pretty big moment. And I think that will trigger a further strong rise in the US dollar, particularly against the euro. The euro is currently 106. The euro will be below parity to the dollar during the course of next year. So those of you who are thinking of investing in Europe can take benefit of this fact to time it more economically beneficially. We're also going to see further deterioration, I believe, in the Chinese economy. I think the economic statistics that are produced there are not always as reliable as perhaps they ought to be. And I think the Chinese economy is struggling more than we are publicly aware. I think that Chinese consumption of raw material is still going to contract. And I think we'll see a further downward move in oil and metal prices. And I think that will quite likely trigger a fairly sharp further sell-off in the stock markets, which recently in the US and in Europe, actually, have been trading at very, very high levels, supported by very low interest rates. So those are my views as to what may happen in the financial world next year. But a very interesting and volatile and a complex time, but fascinating as well. On the political front, I will dare make a couple of forecasts. I as well think that Mr. Corbyn will still be Labour leader. Given three of us think that he is going to be Labour leader this time next year, I guess almost certainly he'll be gone within a week or two, given the track record of this particular panel. And I think the Brexit vote, obviously another very big issue for the UK. I think we'll vote to stay in. I think it'll be a 55-45, not dissimilar to the Scottish referendum. There'll be a lot of noise and heat in the run-up to it. But actually, when it comes to it, I think the British public will vote for the status quo.
Great. And what year should we be buying today?
Oh, well, you could always start with ICAP.
Ed.
I think John is right in terms of his big theme, which is thinking the unthinkable. I mean, I think there's a lot of stuff that we sort of didn't predict or we missed last year that looks kind of obvious this year. So kind of two counterintuitive predictions and one certainty. A sort of counterintuitive one first is, you know, we've been told for years and years, you can't make any money in the music industry. The music industry is completely dead. And not only that, cinemas, who's going to cinemas anymore? Well, look, I give you Adele and I give you Spectre. Adele has sold 3 million CDs in just, 3 million records in just over a week, a million of which are CDs. So people are still buying CDs. And she's done that without any pre-release. She's done that with pretty minimal promotion, although I think the BBC gave her an hour on BBC One, which does help, I must say, probably a little bit anyway. But it's just about expectation, huge expectation there that this is going to be a great record. And she's making a lot of money. The second is the Bond franchise. This is a 60-year-old franchise, and it's responsible for an 11% increase in cinema attendance. It's absolutely phenomenal. It's already grossed about $750 million. It's an absolutely monster thing. So you still can make money in music, and you still can make money in cinema. So I think for me, the sort of the insight there is around how big brands that are trusted can still go quite a long way and can still pack a punch. The second prediction, which is probably around more certainty, I would say, is the extent to which international relations is going to have an impact on domestic politics in the country. Europe first. I'm more worried about Europe than maybe you are, Michael. If you look at the group who want out, they've already hired a super effective American strategist who's got a 90% track record in winning referendums in America. He's signing people up in shopping centres up and down the country, Eurosceptics, to build a grassroots campaign. He says it's all about the emotional argument. How can we deploy an emotional argument that's going to get people out to vote in the referendum and get the UK out of Europe? And he's very, very effective at it. There is no emotional argument, as far as I can see, that's being deployed with the in campaign. It feels very much like a London bubble. It feels quite businessy. And unless they sort of mobilize themselves and get down and dirty, I'm worried that it's going to be extremely close. If not, actually, it might not be the result that many of us want. I think also on the international piece, of course, we'll see what happens with Syria today. But don't expect a resolution with Syria over the next year. This is an incredibly complex situation, and one in which the principal object or the principal group that we're looking to tackle IS is, again, a very complex organisation. It is one that they've made more territorial gains than they've lost since we've been fighting them since September last year. It is, you know, yes, it's in some parts supported by foreign fighters, but by and large, it's Sunni on Sunni. A lot of the big war crimes that are taking place are actually Sunni attacks on Sunni, and it's very tribal as well. So it's far more complex than it looks. And what we know as well, even when you tackle one group, another one pops up. I mean, we, you know, Al-Qaeda were responsible for the, or claim responsibility for the Mali attack last week. Al-Qaeda is more powerful than it's ever been in the last 5 years. Just because it's not in the headlines doesn't mean that it's sort of gone away. So I think tackling extremist sort of violent extremism and jihadism is really difficult because you've got fundamental issues around sort of bulging, youth bulge in the Middle East and North Africa, and also lack of economic opportunity. So I'm not quite sure how bombing them will resolve that in the short term anyway. So that's sort of international relations. The final thing, and this is another sort of counterintuitive, I think actually next year we could potentially grow our attention span rather than shorten it. I mean, we're all worried about our attention span becoming more and more like a goldfish. If you look at mobile video content, the average time we view it is 2 or 3 minutes. The New York Times have just had an experiment with virtual reality. Tessa, you were asking about sort of disruptive technology. And they put in the newspaper, 1.3 million newspapers, a cardboard contraption that's a virtual reality viewer that you slip your smartphone into and watch content. And the content was a 15-minute, quite immersive, emotional documentary about three refugee children. The app that you needed to watch this content was downloaded faster than any other app in the New York Times history. And it's been watched by over, I think, 1.5-2 million people. And not only that, they're watching the full 15 minutes. They're not just sitting there for 2 or 3 minutes. They're actually getting this kind of immersive experience. It's a huge innovation in journalism, I think, virtual reality could be. I think it's quite encouraging, actually.
Yeah. And, of course, that that idea that we actually want to remain connected we want to be face to face, and that prediction that we actually also are fed up with being on our smartphones the whole time.
Yep.
That actually now we want to have more face to face interaction. We want meetings around a table.
No, I think that's exactly right, and I think you see that a little bit in social media trends. But I think what's encouraging out of the New York Times experiment is, and for people like John, is there's a lot of pessimism around journalism. Where's journalism going? How are we going to innovate? And what they've shown is actually there's a technology that can draw you into the story in a way, you know, TV can, but this is even more immersive.
John.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're going to see a resurgence of print, actually. Mm-hmm. You've already seen in publishing that people are going back to books rather than reading on Kindles, because you retain the information, I find, much better in print than you do reading digitally. And the Times print sales are actually up year on year. The organisation is in profit, the paper's in profit for virtually the first time in 230 years. and it's a very positive message. People read the Times pretty thoroughly. When they read on the tablet, they're reading each day for 40 to 50 minutes, the Sunday Times for an hour. People are really interested in reading. And I think print is a resurgent element, that the tactile element of it, and passing papers around, people don't want to lose that. And you're going to see this fall in the sales of newspapers steady and resurgence.
Before I want to come out to the audience, I do have questions ready. We've got four mics in the audience. Just let's pick up this thing in the predictions, that most of you think the European economy is going to do poorly, but most of you think that we will stay in Europe. Now, you're less optimistic from your point of view. What, John, will make people's minds up for them? Will it be economy? Will it be head and heart? Will it be the idea that we have to, for example, after the Paris bombings, we feel more connected with Europe? It's something as simple as that, post-Second World War.
I think it's a bit of that, but I think migration is going to play a huge role in this. And this is the timing of the referendum could be crucial. If you have it before the summer, it advantages those who want to stay in. I think the danger is if you have it in September and you have a migration crisis over the summer, this could really swing votes, because that's going to be a key element, and the OUT campaign will exploit that absolutely ruthlessly. I think it's going to be really close, this referendum. I agree. I think the country can vote to come out.
Tessa?
Well, I think solidarity actually will, and the security that comes from solidarity. I was very interested. Ed, you made the point that it's very difficult to get people enthused about the status quo. So I'm very strongly in favour of our staying in Europe, but we have to build an argument of passion that appeals to the heart, but at the same time has a very clear account of the way in which Europe needs to become much more flexible, much more nimble, and much more able to change. If I just say a quick word about migration. The way in which migration, the crisis generated by thousands and thousands of refugees, has been a failure of leadership in Europe, but also globally. We're seeing America increasingly turning in on itself. The fact is that, by definition, most migrants are educated, ambitious, and resourceful, and I think one of the great challenges for next year is to try and change that argument.
I, like you, in favour of staying in, Tessa, but I disagree that it's hard to convince people of the argument about the status quo. I think people want the status quo. It's a time of huge flux. It's a time of extreme fear. And what I hope is that the debate and the discussion about Europe can be conducted without the usual knee-jerk adherence to the principles of shock, fear, and awe. You know, so it's not just about wonky vegetables and Brussels and bureaucrats and fat cats, but it's actually an engaged, informed discussion that the electorate can participate, because we are capable of having an informed discussion.
Yeah. And one factor I think people haven't really considered yet, but it will come up next year, is that if Britain does vote to come out and Scotland votes to stay in.
Yeah.
They will then go for a referendum, yeah, and you will effectively be voting for the breakup of the United Kingdom.
Which, yes, because the referendum will, I believe, that Scotland will achieve independence.
Okay, well, let's pick up from the audience. I mean, I'm sure there's a hands up coming up. Let's hear who's going to go first. Yes, woman right at the back, we'll take your question first. Anyone over here for seconds? Okay, well, let's have your question. Do say who you are.
Hi, my name's Stephanie McCrell from the World Gold Council. I'm just picking up on this topic. I was wondering, aside from Brexit, do you think there are any other countries in Europe who might be considering exiting Europe as well and might become quite topical over the next year?
Exiting Europe and might become quite topical over the next year. Tessa?
I don't think there's evidence of that, no.
Anyone think there's evidence? Yes, Michael.
Well, I mean, perhaps not exiting Europe, but I think some countries at some point will exit the euro.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think the euro, when it was originally launched, was ludicrously ambitious in the width and the number of countries who were accepted into the eurozone, which frankly didn't achieve a fraction of the economic criteria that were needed. Many of us at the time forecast that this would end in a nasty set of events. What has happened in Greece is manifest in that example, I would say. And in my opinion, at some point, the departure of Greece from the eurozone in time, I think, is an eventuality. And I think quite likely many other countries may leave over time as well.
Ed?
I think what's interesting here is the point around Schengen, actually, because if you see in the papers today, there's pressure on Greece that they'll remove their membership of Schengen if they don't sort out their borders. So I think what you will increasingly see over the course of the next year is that kind of pressure around the outer edges of Europe. Greece is obviously the front line.
John?
This would not happen next year, but the following year you have French elections, and you have Marine Le Pen as a rising force there, who is very anti-Europe. Mm-hmm. And you could, I mean, if the migration crisis continues, if Germany feels the pressure of all these migrants coming in, and hostility to the outside world grows in Europe, and it begins to fracture both in Schengen and the euro, you could see Europe really begin to fracture at its heart through political changes.
Which is ironic, because I think the only way to properly, effectively and decently deal with the migration crisis is for Europe to have a proper policy. I think if there's any fracturing of the European Union, then individual countries, unsupported by the whole, will feel the pressure intolerably, and it will cause, individual economies to collapse.
Okay, questioner right over on the left.
I'm David Hall from Behaviour Change. Who do you think will be leader of the Labour Party for the next election?
Oh, that I should probably just put that to Tessa right now.
I think there's a reasonable chance that Jeremy Corbyn will be leader of the Labour Party at the time of the next election, because, you know, as I was saying, the Labour Party is in one of its phases where the focus is on the internal activity of the Labour Party. The Labour Party, kind of psychologically at the moment, is not a party aspiring to be a party of government. It's aspiring to be an extremely effective party of protest, mobilising people, you know, on marches and so forth. But it is not a party at the moment that's thinking of government. That has to change.
But Tessa, just from a point of view of someone like you in the party, I mean, how do you personally feel in the party now? You know, I speak to people in Labour who feel that they're just totally irrelevant now. I mean, that there's no locus for them in the party.
Well, you know,
How did you last speak to Jeremy Corbyn?
I spoke to the only conversation.
Did you tell him about that shell suit?
What?
Frankly,
no. No, no.
When did you last speak to Jeremy Corbyn?
Well, I'll tell you. I've only ever had one conversation with Jeremy Corbyn, and it was in the summer, and we were both at the funeral of a rather wonderful former Labour leader of Haringey. So I had a brief conversation with him then, but otherwise I've never.
And it was about politics or the person that you're both friendly with?
It was about being at this funeral and our memories of this man. So it wasn't a discussion.
Interestingly, because we've got you here anyway, tell me. Does Jeremy Corbyn make an effort to engage with Labour peers?
Well, I'm not yet fully signed up Labour peer and all the rest of it, but so I can't say that I've had any sort of attempted embrace or reaching out or anything like that. And nor do I expect to. But you see, I think the important thing, Kirsty, is you say, do you feel irrelevant? I certainly don't feel irrelevant. I know what I believe. I have very strong values that have always motivated my politics, and you find other ways of giving practical expression to those. I'm going off to India next year to help develop an academy for girls with a charity that I've worked with for years. I work with London Citizens. You know, I'm working with Chime on business resilience. So there are lots of ways in which, if you are of my politics, which are not the politics of Jeremy Corbyn, you can still be an agent. We hope still be an agent of change.
Interestingly, David Cameron's remark last night, you know, if you vote no, you're, supposed remark, if you vote no, you're likely to be in cahoots with a terrorist sympathiser. Is that your view?
No, I mean, I think that was an extremely stupid and ill-judged thing to do. And that's where he loses it sometimes.
Yeah. John Witherow, who will be the Labour leader at the next election? Will it still be Jeremy Corbyn?
I think it's possible, but I don't really expect it, because I think if he is there in 4.5 years' time, I think the Labour Party will have split by then. I don't think they can sustain Corbyn for all those years. So I expect a challenge, not necessarily next year, but maybe the year after.
Most likely challenger?
Well, I know Dan Jarvis is mobilising, and no doubt others are too. So, but there is, at the moment, no clear challenger who can take him on.
I was thinking there's a spectre of David Miliband on the horizon. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. I would say this, though, that instead of those within the Labour Party, you know, moaning that Corbyn isn't reaching out to X, Y and Z, they should see this and embrace this as an opportunity for profound change. The Labour Party has been foundering in the popular imagination since Iraq. And really, this is a painful but important chance for it to truly and properly kind of rebirth itself in the popular imagination.
It
won't be me, I can predict that. That's not what this country needs. Is somebody who watching people making cakes in a tent. That's not who you need leading this country.
Michael Svensson.
My money is that John Witherow is right, that Corbyn will survive a year, the Labour Party will go through further turmoil and a truly existential crisis. And at some point, Corbyn will leave. And we won't know a day beforehand when it's going to happen. It'll happen suddenly, unexpectedly.
He'll just leave.
He will just leave.
Like the
Berlin Wall. It'll happen and no one will be able to forecast when it'll happen. And when it does happen, my money is on Chakumana.
Okay, Ed Williams.
I mean, Jeremy Corbyn's a bit like John Sargent on Strictly Come Dancing. I mean, he keeps on going and going and going and going. And I think he'll keep on going. And the problem...
Will he have a shadow cabinet?
The problem for Labour is the rules have changed. So you've got this big bulge of young people, you know, seemingly sensible, you know, intelligent young people who are voting for him and have elected him in large numbers. So the idea that he, a bit like John Sargent turning his back on the Strictly crown, the idea that Jeremy Corbyn will turn his back on all of those students, I think is sort of unthinkable, actually. And that's why I thought his comment to Marr on Sunday was actually got to the heart of it. So I think he might go on a little bit longer than we think.
Tessa.
Yeah, you see, I think Sue is right that the Labour Party has kind of brought this on itself because of an inability to adapt, modernise, keep pace with change after the years when Tony Blair was Prime Minister. And there's
no complacency to add to that. If you look at Scotland, it was total complacency.
Well, exactly. Ceasing to be activist. Yeah. And what Jeremy Corbyn, this movement, has offered is a different kind of activism. However, I think that, you know, if you sat down and surveyed in detail all these young followers, they follow... Jeremy Corbyn's like a kind of receptacle. He can be anything you want him to be.
Ooh.
When it's not... No,
Justin Bieber.
Exactly. Well, almost, yes. If anything that you want him to be that you dislike about the status quo.
Yes. No, gentlemen, right at the back, yeah.
Again, Jeff, from Question Time. Just going back to the European referendum for a minute, John and Sue talked about Scotland. Do you think the argument around Scotland leaving the UK, if the UK leaves the EU, will play a factor in the referendum to everyone, really? Is that the kind of emotional thing that would influence people in England? And to Tessa, you talked about having been through this before and being abused at local meetings and so on. Do you think the Labour Party could split if MPs start being deselected? Because, of course, the difference with last time is that the people wanting to move the Labour Party left were not in control of the Labour Party.
Well, let's deal with that last one first, because Tessa was shaking her head when Sue was talking about a split. So you don't think there'll be a split?
I don't believe that the Labour Party will split. I think there will become a point when Labour members who are serious about the prospect of government locally or nationally, will be heard. I think the first moment for that will be May next year, when there are a lot of elections. And if Labour does badly, that will force the party to confront the fact that it has to choose between being a party of protest, never actually giving effect to change in people's lives, or once again, the ambition to be a party of government.
Sue.
I don't think those are mutually exclusive things, though, that the idea that one can have strong ideals and be unelectable. I mean, I don't think they're...
No, I'm not saying that. I'm absolutely not saying that. But that the Jeremy Corbyn movement is a movement of protest. But, of course, good politics is both activist, ambitious, but with the belief, the central belief, is that you have to win power in order to achieve change.
Well, let's move on now to talk about whether or not that Scottish question will play a part in the referendum, because there's a kind of funny dilemma there, isn't there, for Nicola Sturgeon, because, of course, she wants a yes vote in Scotland, but she actually probably wants a no vote in England. So, therefore, she can't campaign too hard with her MPs at Westminster south of the border on that. However, that would be the only trigger, wouldn't it? Because, I mean, the word is that Nicola Sturgeon, the last thing she wants is a referendum before she is ready for a referendum. So, John, will it play a factor?
In the same way she wanted a Tory government to win the last election. I think it will, because if those who are tempted by Britain to come out of Europe see Britain in this role as a small power that can trade right across the world. If the concept arises that it'll be just England and Wales and Northern Ireland, people will begin to question, hang on, can we do that? It won't be this United Kingdom, it'll be disunited. And people will worry about the future much more of that unit than Great Britain and Northern Ireland. So I think it will play a part in that.
But of course, there's the other question. If that were to happen, Scotland as a member of Europe would be a new entity and might, as we know from Catalonia, there may be opposition.
Opposition?
To Scotland being in Europe.
Yes, there may, and there's no guarantee, of course, that they can get that.
Yep.
So that's the gamble she's got to play.
Ed?
I mean, I think the Scottish dimension to this is one of the more compelling arguments for actually staying in if it's deployed well. I'm a bit more pessimistic, actually, than Sue about the extent to which this whole European argument will be rationally for, and there will be, you know, a sense of, you know, high quality debate. I think it's going to very quickly descend, particularly given the people involved on the outside. I think it's going to very quickly descend to sort of pandering to people's own sort of petty views of the world, and it will be, I think, fought through the tabloids as well. So I'd love it to be a sort of quite high level rational argument. I just don't think it will be.
Well, I think if you look at the way that the Scottish, I mean, obviously in the extremes of either argument, there's none too sort of pleasant badinage. But you know, centrally, what happened during the Scottish referendum is that vast swathes of the electorate were energised by interesting debates, and I believe that is possible.
Interesting, lots of them young people, the same people that have been energised, cohort that's been energised by Jeremy Corbyn.
Yeah,
because you don't underestimate young people. And you know.
Because they're not stupid. They're not just, you know, pot-headed, idealists.
What's that?
You know, they don't know. Whatever that is.
Yeah.
I hear chat of it. Certain social circles. But, you know, I think you write off, you know, young people are the lifeblood of Britain and Europe. And to write them off as just, you know, reactionaries who just use Jeremy Corbyn as a vessel to pour their mistrust and hatred of the system is do them such a great disservice, I think.
Gentlemen there.
Peter Graham from Musations. I agree with Ed's observation that a lot of people voting in the referendum will be swayed by emotional arguments. And I wonder how key David Cameron's attempts to gain some concessions from Europe will be in swaying people in that emotional argument. So how successful do the panel believe that Cameron will be in gaining any concessions?
Michael Spencer.
I think Cameron and his team are going to have a tough time getting substantial concessions. It's not going to be an easy task for them. And I think they need to deploy a huge amount of effort through the Foreign Office and all the other contacts they've got within Europe to persuade our European partners at the moment that they need the UK to stay in. And if they want the UK to stay in, they really need to be able to give David something that is plausible as Prime Minister that he can sell to this country. Because if he really does come back, pretty near empty-handed. I think that makes the process of launching a convincing argument to stay, notwithstanding the issues about Scotland, incredibly difficult. So a lot of pressure is on the Prime Minister, the Chancellor and their teams to get those concessions and get them early in the new year.
Tessa.
I think the problem is that David Cameron has got himself so far back from the kind of relationships he needs to have with other European leaders that he's surrendered an awful lot of negotiating leverage. There are changes that are necessary, but, you know, this...
What changes do you think?
Well, I think that, you know, Europe needs to be organised in a way which is much more focused on growth and dealing with the stagnation in the European economy. Needs to have much more competence to show leadership. For instance, there will be another crisis akin to the migrant crisis that will hit Europe in the next 5 years. But Europe is not competent as now to do that. There isn't a sense of a sufficient sense of coming together in single European interest-focused leadership. But so The problem is that the whole European argument in this country has been predicated on Tory party management rather than national interest. That's the greatest charge that David Cameron has to face on this.
John.
Yeah, I think he's made very modest demands and he's not going to get them. And I think the opposition will eviscerate him in the debate that's to come. And that's a real problem. It's going to swing a lot of people towards out. They will be arguing over sovereignty of Parliament and control of our borders, and he doesn't have any answers to that.
Now, the Times has played a straight bat in many ways, but do you think, what will the position be, do you think?
I think what our readers want is it to both sides to be fairly represented. So that's what we intend to do, to cover the debate incredibly seriously and to represent what both sides want without being partisan.
Ed.
Look, I mean, part of the problem is, I think if you met normal people on the street, they wouldn't be able to tell you what the concessions are or what the arguments are. And look, John is right. We're at the moment, it's sort of tinkering around the edges. So there's not going to be a moment in which David Cameron is going to say, aha, look what I've done. The world looks completely different now. Our relationship with Europe is more rebalanced. I've gone big and I've delivered this from Brussels. This is not going to happen. And so all the other stuff we're talking about is so small, and it's the minutiae of it that to kind of normal people up and down the country is completely irrelevant. So in some respects, hilariously enough, I don't think it's even going to be really part of the debate.
You say that, but actually the kind of thing that people actually do look at, especially in terms of welfare cuts, is welfare for migrant families and whether or not they should get that and whether they shouldn't, and there already are some restrictions.
Yeah.
That kind of argument probably does
that
does
will have
resonate.
Resonance. And you should expect somebody like Jerry Gunster, who is the American political campaigner behind the Out campaign, to seize on precisely that point, actually.
I sort of feel that in order to have affected the change that he wanted, David Cameron, you're right, Tessa, needed to have been at the table earlier on. It's too late to come right now and go, this is what I want, this is what I want. And you're also right that the changes that will be affected aren't the sort of sexy changes that the electorate are really going to respond to. If I'm really honest, I think that the people will vote now. If you do a snap poll now, it won't be dissimilar to when the actual referendum happens.
Yes, questioner here. Thank you.
Hans Kinker from Mitsubishi Electric. I would like to take this one step further, and we're looking into the crystal ball. So what do you think would happen to Great Britain if the Brexit were to happen, and what would happen to Europe?
John.
Well, it comes back to this point, would it remain a United Kingdom? And my hunch is it would not. Would Europe care a bit? I think Germany and the Netherlands and others very much want us in there. It wouldn't fundamentally change Europe because we're out of so many parts of it already, all semi-detached. So it's not going to change Europe.
to coin an old phrase, yes. Michael.
I don't agree with John that Europe would sail on calmly and serenely in the event of the departure of the UK. I think actually Europe would itself begin to go through an existential crisis, particularly, by the way, if the UK performed better economically, perhaps, and embarked upon a series of economic reforms outside of the EU that would be less easy to do inside the EU. So I think it would be genuinely extremely bad for the European Union to lose the UK. After all, we are the second largest economy. We've got better growth rate prospects. We bring with us so much. So I think it would be a tragedy for the EU, which is one of the reasons I rather urge Cameron and his team to refresh our European partner leaders, that he needs help to keep them in. Because at the end of the day, if we're going to stay in, actually it needs a passionate sell by Cameron as to the long-term future of Europe. You know, that if the UK stays within Europe and engages properly and passionately and committedly to the European cause, can we then assist and be part of the process of change that is undoubtedly needed within the EU?
Exactly.
He might come to you and give you a few bob for a couple of speeches.
I don't think so.
Tessa.
But that's right. You've got to tap in to the kind of predisposition to be optimistic. And, you know, I really hate the thought that we exit Europe. It will take something pretty intangible away from our shared character, our openness, our tolerance, our sense of interdependence, quite apart from the untested impact, the untested economic impacts. But we need, there is no passion. You know, Alan Johnson argues with greater passion about the importance of Europe than David Cameron has ever done. And that's because all the time he's looking at the splits in his own party rather than looking at the national interest. And it's such a serious failure of our Prime Minister.
Alan Johnson, Prime Minister? Alan Johnson, Labour leader?
Nope.
Never,
nope.
ever, ever. Never ruled himself out. Never, ever. Ed?
I think part of the problem is we don't really know. I mean, as Tessa says, these are untested economic impacts. We have no idea. And that, in my mind, plays to the, as John said, you know, probably the belief that actually nothing's really going to happen, nothing is really going to change. So the danger then is you get quite a lot of apathy. So people don't turn out because they think, actually, is anything really going to change? And the people who do turn out are the people who want us to exit. And if you look at the people who are likely to vote for an out, they're older, much older. Many of them are retired. And forgive me, they've got a lot of time on their hands as well. So they are much more inclined to get out and vote on the day. So I think you've really got to the kind of nub of the issue is, which we don't really know what's going to happen.
Woman in the middle.
It's Monica Whitley from The Economist. If we could turn away from UK and Europe to the US, John, you introduced the frankly frightening idea of President Trump. If you could give your rationale behind that idea and why the American public won't eventually wake up and realize this is truly ruinous for all of us.
The rationale was expect the unexpected, and everybody's writing him off, Trump, and saying he's gonna disappear soon. Well, he isn't. He's still retaining this huge lead. And the others are not rising up yet. I mean, the pundits predict Rubio for lots of good cephalogical reasons that Rubio will come through. It's who knows? I mean, he may not. But the fact Trump is still so strong and has this huge support across the Midwest of the United States, I mean, he could go the whole way. And people are now beginning to come to terms with that possibility.
So if you suggest that Hillary will be the candidate, as obviously the survey suggests, then, you know, is she going to get absolute tsunami about emails and other things once she is the candidate? Is something else going to break?
I don't know. I think she's dealt with a lot of that. Whether it'll carry on, I don't think so. I think it's been going so long, it's now more or less in the past. She's obviously an incredibly strong candidate, and there will be a big desire to elect, I think, a woman as President of the United States. So that plays very much in her favor. But then you've had 8 years of Democrats, and there tends to be swings. So the Republicans have got that advantage.
Anyone else like to come in on this?
I feel so depressed right now.
Oh.
Because I think, first of all, we've had the existential crisis of leaving Europe, then the existential crisis of England as the Union shatters, and now the prospect of Donald Trump as the president. Much as I know you were evidencing the worst-case scenario there, I can't see it.
I don't know. I mean, Trump is the most extraordinary phenomenon, actually. You've got somebody that says utterly ridiculous, frankly, insane things that are taken seriously. And the part of that is we're in this world now where, you know, if you don't believe anything, you believe everything. And you can sort of say anything, and it suddenly is debated as a serious suggestion. The registry for Muslims in America. Suddenly, he says this in a Q&A. Suddenly everyone's talking about it. Now, 90% of people on the mass media say this is crazy. Remember World War II? This is absolute madness. Nevertheless, there's 10% who think, maybe it's not a bad idea. It's completely mad. And I saw some frightening statistics recently. 83%, I think, or over 80% of those Republican GOP members think that a Muslim should never be a president in the United States. 50%, I think, of GOP members in Iowa think that actually there shouldn't even be a Muslim religion in America. So you've got this, frankly, frightening thing happening. And in my in my mind, part of it is, Michael, I think Michael is part of the kind of economics of America at the moment. You've got a frustrated middle class who feel that they don't have enough opportunity. Foreign policy is something done by kind of elites in Washington. So it panders to Trump, and you've got a whole series of, as I say, frankly, mad ideas that are doing the rounds of sensible policy. And they're not being shut down.
Well, I mean, the only thing I'm hoping is that John, having forecast that Trump would win the Republican nomination, that the track record of this panel will continue its past previous record and be 100% wrong. Yeah.
Because have you had dealings with him?
No. God, no.
No. Tessa.
You see, I think that the Trump phenomenon, and in a way also the Corbyn phenomenon, goes to one of Sue's earlier points, which I don't think we've really quite finished, which is, you know, the future belongs to those leaders who remain authentic, activist, and electable. And what people feel is, I'm going to vote for that guy, Donald Trump, because, you know, I feel suffocated by the elite. Mm. You know, there is an elite, I'll never be part of it. Yep. I'll never, you know, I don't know anybody like that. So this guy will stand up for me. And I think there's something similar in a completely different part of the political spectrum with in relation to Jeremy Corbyn. And that's why I say, you know, that he's a way of expressing a kind of frustration that people feel. And I sense that we're all here rather incompetent to do anything about that. But it is this combination of real authentic activism and the ability to lead, which is the great yawning gap.
We can't say that Corbyn represents real, authentic activism, really, Tessa. I mean, he's a peddler of theories that were promoted years ago, and when practiced by other countries in Latin America and elsewhere in more recent
that
years, have resulted in catastrophic failure.
Yeah, but that is
so this is authentic activism.
That view
it's
is
naive
precisely
populist policy based on fantasy ideas.
We're seeing the growth of populism, but it's precisely that view which is driving people who've never been active in politics before to him.
That's quite right. And just going back on America, the fact that you could have had at one stage we thought this was going to be a Clinton-Bush election. Mm. The very fact we could have had that leads to this protest. Elite. They are just fed up with the elites.
Elites. Yes, women in the front row.
Gervla McFadden, Edwardian Hotels, London. Given the forthcoming decision today and also the European argument we're currently having, what impact do you think this will have on travel trends next year, and particular as London as a destination?
Mm. Aha, right. Well, Tessa, you at one point did think that you might be the candidate for mayor of this great city.
I'm so sorry. I've got an ear infection in this ear, so okay.
What we've been talking about Europe and also about the world's insecurity, what do you think the impact will be on London, on travel plans for people, and particularly how will it impact on London as a destination?
You mean the sense of
security and insecurity?
Security,
in the sense that people might not travel as much because they want to feel safe at home, but then London may be a target. So what from the point of view of the hotel industry, what will the impact of the present insecurity be?
And London as a desirable location.
And
London as a desirable location.
Yeah. I don't actually think it will have that the impact will be significant. I think that tourism in London has been extraordinarily resilient. People want to come here. And I also think there's a high level of confidence. You know, as I say this, I feel I've got to touch wood and cross my fingers and all the rest of it. There is a high level of confidence in the capability of our security services, who've disrupted seven plots in the last year. Right. But also, you know, policing, security. I mean, London is a safe city.
Okay, now,
except when you take 7-7. I don't think it will have an effect, and I think that we should not allow it to enter our consciousness as a threat to the city.
Now, as always happens at these kind of events, hands are popping up all over the place now, just as we're about to finish. But I do want to capture your views in the hope that they're more accurate than the survey that you delivered last year. So what I would like to do is hands up. There were some hands up with mics. You've got a mic, there's something about you've got a mic, and you've got a mic. I want to take 3 points. Yes, gentleman at the back first.
Slightly off the wall one here, but Ed Dewar from Billfinger GVA. Richard Godwin in the Evening Standard last week said that jihadists are just proof of a crisis in masculinity. He called them the small penis brigade because they would rather point an AK-47 at a woman than speak to one. Okay. Do you think that 2016 would see a further decline in masculinity? And do you agree in that sentiment?
Okay, well, we'll carry that with us. Carry that thought in your head. Gentleman there.
Go follow that. Why isn't housing going to be a bigger issue next year?
Okay, thank you very much. Housing. And yes, the woman on the left.
Anna Wallace, PwC. It's related to John's point that the Times readers expect a balanced view of the EU referendum. I'm interested in the panel's views on the media in 2016 and their responsible or otherwise reporting of the news. And in particular, I think that young people today feel disconnected and feel that actually the British media doesn't represent their views either in the way or the content that it covers.
Okay, well, luckily, I'm going to begin with the last one first, and I'm going to throw that straight to Ed. The media in 2016 doesn't accord or indeed connect with young people in the way that either they absorb their news or are interested in the news.
Well, I think the first thing, I mean, interesting to see ITV have now got Allegra Stratton after Peston, both of whom now will be on ITV News. So it's good to see, as a former BBC employee, it's good to see, forgive me, Adam, it's good to see great BBC journalism now spreading out to the commercial world. Of course, Sky News is brilliant as well. Adam and Angie would give me hell if I didn't say that, and it's also true. In terms of whether the media is not representative to young people, I'm not really sure, because actually last year I said I thought that this year was going to see a revival in traditional media, and all the numbers suggest that actually. The most popular news sites are not BuzzFeed and Huffington Post. They're actually a lot of the traditional news media, like John's paper. So actually you're seeing young people coming to trusted big media brands, and I think you'll see that accentuated actually over the coming years.
Right, let's move on next. And why is housing not a bigger issue on the agenda? Tessa.
Well, I was thinking about that actually this morning, about the, and actually, I mean, housing, it is the biggest crisis facing young people, certainly in this city. Across the UK, there are 250,000 people go to sleep every night waiting for a council house, a place to get to the top of the housing waiting list. And I think the reason it's something that, you know, if you're in politics, you live with all the time, and you live all the time with the big promises that action is going to follow. There's quite a time lag between saying you're going to build 100,000 homes in London and anybody actually getting the keys and moving in, 2 or 3 years. It is the biggest crisis that faces the long-term success of London. I think that's without doubt.
Michael Spencer.
I mean, I completely concur that the housing issue for the country whole is a very, very important one, needs to be addressed, and as urgently, I think Osborne, the Chancellor, is doing a decent job. I would, however, personally say that I think what he's done on stamp duty in the housing market actually has increased the cost of moving so considerably. That is actually net-net not a good thing for the housing market. I think he's gone too far.
John.
I agree. The market's stagnating because of these stamp duty taxes. They've all talked about housing for years, but they've done very little. I think government should be doing far more. Zach Goldsmith actually has some good ideas about increasing.
They're
mine. well, he's nicked yours. I think government should be in there behind builders on brownfield sites, just developing as many as possible.
They're mine.
Okay, I think we should finish. I think we should finish with Sue on the crisis. Well, ever in the crisis of masculinity.
What? What kind of dim view do you have to take of mankind that you believe the knee-jerk reaction of an average man when faced with feminism, when faced with women empowering themselves in the modern world, is to point a rifle at their head? I mean, it is a seriously wayward piece of journalism, if you ask me, and not one that reflects in any way the true crisis happening in the Middle East, which is predicated not on man's desire to kill and club, woman gets strong, man kill woman. Nothing to do with that. It's to do with, you know, people who feel disenfranchised. It's to do with tribal affiliations. It's to do with ancient primal wounds. It's also, more importantly, to do with all of us, men or women, taking responsibility, making sure that those in our society who aren't looked after, who aren't engaged, who don't feel part of the whole, we reach out to them, whether we're in politics or whether we're just on the street. And I'm furious on behalf of all men. Anyway.
Take that. So now, with that, I think I can hand over either for a comment on that or to close as well to Ed.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Well, look, thank you to all the panellists. It's another brilliant year. This gets actually better and better each year. So thank you also, Kirsty, to you for your brilliant chairing of a very lively debate. And also to all the wonderful panellists as well. It really just leaves me to make a plug, really. So we have got... in January, as many of you know, the annual Edelman Trust Barometer is published. It is the longest, most serious, most respected piece of longitudinal study into trust in the world. 27 countries, 35,000 people are sampled. It's, you know, it's like wine. It gets better and better each year. And last year, some of you were here to listen to the outgoing head of MI6, the chief, John Sauls, who gave the trust lecture. The year before was the brilliant John Brown, formerly of BP. I'm hoping in the next few days that I'll be able to announce who the big speaker is for January. And all things being equal, it looks like it's going to be another really interesting speaker and another really good event. So I'm looking forward to seeing you then. It's around, 19th, I think? 19th of January, just before Davos. So thanks very much. But otherwise, thank you very much to the panel and to Kirsty.
Thank you very much. It's been a lovely session. Thank you.